my mic is live. Hi again.
Good afternoon, everyone. You are the most obedient audience I have ever dealt with here at GSO, I have to say. I'm Judith Swift. I'm the director of the Coastal Institute, and I'm very, very happy to welcome you all today to URI's beautiful Bay Campus. Now, many of you work and virtually live here at the Bay Campus, but for those of you who don't come here regularly, we do suffer working here. It's tough. It's a tough gig, but we do our best. I'm going to ask, because we are live streaming at this point, thanks to the Interspace Center, thank you guys very, very much. At some point, we're going to ask you all to behave like benthic creatures, just so that we don't confuse the audiences when they tune into Interspace Center B-roll. But in any case, I'm going to ask Bruce Corliss if he would just stand up for a moment, wave to the folks back there and everyone else, and thank you, Bruce, for being here. There we go. As we know, this is the home of the Graduate School of Oceanography and always a sterling jewel in the crown of URI it has been for many, many decades. And I want to welcome everybody who's watching online. I want to let you folks know that we are going to be having a Q&A following Dan's talk. And during that period, we're going to ask you to wait for the microphone to get to you so it can be picked up by folks who are watching online. Okay, next year we're going to add a feature of having people able to text in questions, which I think is always interesting because we can then choose to answer them or not. And this is the fourth annual Scott W. Nixon lecture. We're really thrilled to have the speaker who we have today, but I first want to thank the members of the committee who made this selection: Michael Pilsen, Candace Oviatt, Anton Post, Autumn Moskowski, and Nicole Rohr, and Amber Neville. And they did let me sit in. And I particularly want to say thank you for their insight and wisdom on our selections for the last several years. But also, I want to make a special thanks to Nicole for organizing, Dan, what is going to feel like more of a marathon by tomorrow afternoon. You know, one of the things that they're doing tomorrow is actually going out kayaking on Narrow River. And as we all know, 40-degree weather is perfect for kayaking. You know, and we're hoping there's going to be a good strong wind, too. I understand Veronica Baranski has some gauges ready to test how quickly hypothermia sets in, so, you know, we're good to go. But thank you all so much for the work that you've done. It certainly does take a village. We also have here Ayla Fox, who is running around with the camera, and she's taking photos for this event. There we are, Ayla. Ayla is also our brilliant URI alum who does videography for a lot of people on campus at this point. If you do not want Ayla to take your picture because you're in WITSEC, now is the time to tell us all. Okay? I want the logic of that to flow through the room here for a moment. The other thing is that there will be a reception that will follow the talk that's going to begin at about 5 p.m. And the Graduate School of Oceanography bookstore is going to be open. And goodness knows there is nothing that says Mother's Day like a t-shirt with an anchor on it. So, to introduce Dan, we have a GSO alumna and one of Scott's many successful students who are actually as ubiquitous as nutrients are. Robinson Wally Fulweiler, who is an associate professor with the Departments of Earth and Environment and Biology at Boston University. In this academic year, she is on sabbatical, which is why, of course, we made her do something extra, as a Bullard Fellow at Harvard University. Wally is an ecosystems ecologist and biogeochemist, and her research is focused on answering fundamental questions about energy flow in biogeochemical cycling of nutrients, carbon and oxygen in a variety of environments. She's especially interested in how anthropogenic changes affect the ecology and elemental cycling of ecosystems on a variety of scales, such as nutrient loading, regional, global, climate change, etc. Her current research is centered on the transformations and the ultimate fate of nitrogen in the marine environment and the impact of climate change on benthic pelagic coupling. And in brief, what that means is Wally will understand Dan's talk. So, having said that, Wally, would you come up and do our introduction? Thank you so much.
Well, thank you for that nice introduction and giving me the opportunity to introduce Dr. Daniel Conley. It is both my pleasure and my privilege. I've known Dan now for over a decade, which dates us a little bit. I first was introduced to him because he was the handling editor in biogeochemistry for a manuscript that Scott and I wrote about silica cycling, most importantly terrestrial silica cycling on the Wood-Pocketuck watershed, which is not too far from here. So I got to meet him there, and then I got to sort of be introduced to him there, and then I got to actually meet him at a eutrophication conference in Denmark, and I remember really well, it was a weird building, and there was these wooden sofas with light blue sofa cushions, and we sat and chatted all about silica, and it was wonderful. So that is how it began. And then sort of just to make it kind of, I don't know, full circle, Dan published a paper in Nature and Geoscience Commentary with my first PhD student, Dr. Joanna Carey, last year. So the connections with the Nixon lab continue. Of course, that's not why Daniel is here. He is here because he is a well-known and prolific scientist with well over 100 publications and an H index over 60. He started his work in New Orleans at the University of Tulane, and then got his master's in Wisconsin in environmental science, his PhD in chemical oceanography at the University of Michigan. From there, he had a sort of a brief stint at Horn Point Laboratory before he decided to become a full-time expat scientist, where he went to Denmark and was working there for almost 10 years. And then with the successful awarding of a Madame Curie Fellowship, he went to Lund University, where he has been ever since. His accolades are long and, in fact, could fill up another for probably the duration of this talk, so I won't do that. I'll just sort of mention three, probably, of the top three that I can think of. First, he was awarded a Pew Conservation Fellowship, which is awesome. he was became a member of the Royal Academy for Swedish Science in 2014. And he was also awarded the Ruth Patrick Award from the Association of Sciences, Limnology, and Oceanography, or ASLO. And I think that one's particularly meaningful and probably extends well to what he's going to be talking about today, because that is an award given to a scientist that connects their rigorous science to sort of management solutions, right? So it's applying excellent science to figuring out what problems are and how we can fix that. The Ruth Patrick Award is awarded to him in 2014. So it's really wonderful that you're here, Daniel, and we're so excited about it. And really, the only thing that would make it better would be if Scott Nixon was here with us. I think he'd be sitting right about there, and he would have sort of a lightly colored pink, maybe, short sleeve shirt on and some sort of plaid, and it would be great. So without further ado, Dr. Daniel Conley.
Thank you, Wally, for that introduction. It's both a pleasure to be here and also an honor to give the Scott Nixon lecture. I never had the opportunity to work together with Scott or to collaborate with him, but we just clicked from the moment that we met. We clicked and talked science, and I had the pleasure of bringing him to Denmark once for a national conference on eutrophication. But the only problem was the entire conference was held in Danish. So after the first morning, Scott and I escaped, and had 3 days to just talk. And, it was just a lovely 3 days, and I really got to know him well there. I must admit, I did unintentionally try to kill him at a Thai restaurant by feeding him hot peppers that looked like flowers, but he survived that, and I'm happy. Scott was an amazing person. I think what I admire about him the most was he was willing to stand up and say things that maybe people didn't want to hear. And I think that's is one of his crowning characteristics. So I'm going to talk about hypoxia today in the Baltic Sea. It has lots of parallels to places around the world, but it's also a really well-studied estuarine system. And I think you'll find some of the stories here interesting. When you do ecosystem science, I have a number of co-authors here, you never do things alone. You do them in coordination with other people. And I also want to thank my funders. We've been generously supported, really, for the last decade doing this work on hypoxia in the Baltic Sea. So I went to the website recently, and there's 762 sites experiencing coastal hypoxia. The numbers keep growing. It's partly because we're looking around for these sites as well. But there was a paper that just came out in Global Biogeochemical Cycles, and it was reported in US News and World Report today that the oceans are dying because of the increase in hypoxia that's coming with global warming. And it's quite interesting. It is really a serious problem that we have in our coastal waters. Does anyone have any idea how many sites they have found in lakes? No idea? So this paper also was recently out in Global Biogeochemical Cycles, and there's 365 sites that they've identified. Many of them have had hypoxia for the last 300 years, And a number of them, 71 of them, have had hypoxia only in the last 100 years. And it's very strongly associated with urbanization. And it's interesting, it's not associated with farming or other nutrient inputs, but it was strongly correlated to urbanization. So they're experiencing the same kinds of things in freshwaters as we see in coastal marine environments. So I'm going to give you some perspective about where I live today. I live in Scandinavia, in the Baltic Sea. I live in Sweden. I had lived in Denmark previously, and this is the Baltic Sea. I'll talk a lot about the Baltic proper, which is this part of the Baltic Sea. There's a sill here that controls the saltwater input to the northern part. This is very fresh, ranging from 3 to 5. There are sills here that control the saltwater input from the North Sea and the Kattegat into the Baltic Sea. And they strongly regulate the amount of saltwater that can come in. So the salinity of most of the Baltic proper is in the surface water somewhere between 5 and 6, and the bottom waters can go all the way up to 12. It's semi-enclosed, it's non-tidal. It has a mean depth of 55 meters. There's a deep spot over here that's nearly 460 meters deep. And it's basically, at least the Baltic proper and the Kattegat is permanently stratified and at about 70 to 90 meters, and probably has been that way for a very long time. There's 14 countries within the drainage area. And these countries work together to help protect the Baltic Sea through the Helsinki Commission. And there's 85 million people in the watershed. So it is really a heavily impacted system. It also has a long residence time. The Baltic proper has a residence time of 30 years. So anything that we do to it today will be around for a period of time. Probably the most important thing about this country that I live in now, this wonderful country of Scandinavia, I won't talk about its social programs or healthcare because that's a political question. I won't go there right now, but I will talk about the cuisine in Denmark and Sweden. And the most important thing is the herring we have, the rotten herring. It's just amazing. So a few years ago, we've been working on the open waters, but we decided to try and look at the coastal waters for hypoxia. And it turns out that each country has their own database. So we put a group of people together, and I think we were 22 people, and we dug through lots of different data archives and looked at the appearance of hypoxia in the Baltic Sea. And it turns out we have records, water column records, for the many of the coastal areas that go back into the 1960s. And we divided them up into different categories, if they were anoxic or if they were hypoxic. And one of the things we found 613 coastal units. There's more than one sample in many of the different coastal sites. And 215 had experienced hypoxia during the last 10 or 15 years, which is really quite a number. And it's very spatially distributed. You can see along here on the border of Germany and Poland and Latvia and Estonia, there's essentially no hypoxia at all. And it has to do with the fact that they're very open systems, very sandy, and there's no stratification. Here in the Gulf of Finland, and especially in the archipelagos, Finland and the Stockholm Archipelago, there's many systems that have experienced anoxia and hypoxia during this time period. And it's all the enclosed ecosystems along Sweden and Denmark that experience this. But what's interesting and what's different from the Baltic proper is it's seasonal. It disappears. It's there intermittently between June and some systems all the way up into October. And so it disappears every year. There's only 3 estuarine systems along the coast that has hypoxia that's permanent. The other interesting thing, if you go up to the Bothnian Bay and the Bothnian Sea, you see just a handful of red marks. And you have very low populations, low nutrient input loading in these areas. But these red dots are from places where there are paper mills. And they regulated paper mills probably 25 years ago, but they're fiber banks that have been built up outside the former paper mills that are still consuming oxygen today. This is some work I'm really proud of. It's work that we've done on the Baltic proper. How many have measured oxygen doing a Winkler titration? All right. So the Winkler titration was actually invented in 1888. And so there's been measurements on the Baltic Sea from 1896. And the problem is they're sparse measurements. And so we developed a technique to look at the AOU, the apparent oxygen utilization. So even though you have only a handful of measurements, you can use this decrease in oxygen with depth to model the oxygen concentrations throughout the Baltic. And so you can see these gaps in the record. This is World War I and World War II. But you can see this increase in hypoxia with time. This is where the area of the thermocline or the halocline is. And you can see today we're averaging something on the order of 65,000 square kilometers of area that's hypoxic. And it's gone up almost close to where the permanent halocline is. You can see there was this drop in the 1990s. This was called the Great Baltic Stagnation Period. And it was a period of time where there were not large saltwater inflows going into the Baltic. And saltwater is important because it renews oxygen, but it also creates stratification and it reduces mixing. And so when you have more saltwater coming in the Baltic, you have more hypoxia. And you can see the relatively small amounts of area at the turn of the last century, how it increased with time. And now we have these really large areas that are even anoxic as well as being hypoxic. And this is all attributed to the increases in nutrient loading through time. The top one is the input of nitrogen, both from land and from the atmosphere, and the increase in phosphorus. And as many systems around the world, the increases in nutrients seriously began with the industrialization of agriculture and the use of artificial fertilizers. So we have something called the Baltic Sea Action Plan to reduce nutrients, and we have made big progress since the peak in nutrient inputs in the 1980s, but we've taken most of the low-hanging fruit, and now we're working on the stubborn sources. The nitrogen inputs are very heavily controlled by water flow, and so a lot of this variation is simply due to the input of water into the system. And you can see that we still have a way to go to reduce nutrients to an acceptable level. So one of the questions you can ask, we know that there had been a hypoxia in the past from geological studies. And you can ask the question, is hypoxia a natural feature of the Baltic Sea? Is it just something that we have to accept living on the shores of the Baltic Sea? Or can we do something about it? And so we've been using the sediments, the sediment record, especially the appearance of laminated sediments. And you get laminated sediments when there's no oxygen, because there's no benthic organisms that are there to mix the sediments. And so you get these really nice sediment records in the deep basins of the Baltic Sea. So a few years ago, we put together a picture of 30 different sediment cores around the Baltic. And it turns out that it varies depending on what part of the Baltic Sea you're in. And it's interesting because the Germans are focusing on one area, and they were arguing with the Swedes who were focusing on another area, saying, you don't know how to take your cores. The cores, the ship is going up and down, and you're not getting complete core collection. And it turned out that if you put all the 30 records together, there was a common pattern throughout the period. And so we have hypoxia that starts when it became a brackish sea, when the sea level rose and salt water started to come into the Baltic. And so we have this period of hypoxia that lasted about 4,000 years. And you can see it in the laminated sediments. You can see it in the organic carbon distributions. And this is an estimate of what the salinity was based on different organisms. 4,000 years ago, hypoxia disappeared. And what we think it was from is that it was cooler. The Holocene thermal maximum disappeared. You also had morphological changes. So a sill developed between the northern basin of the Baltic and the southern basin, and we believe that it became a phosphorus sink when it became oxygenated. And there were also reductions in salinity that reduced the stratification. And it's interesting, the Baltic was oxic again for a period of about 2,000 years. And then during the medieval warm period, it actually started in the Roman warm period, it increased again. And we believe this has a lot to do with not only warmer conditions, but land clearance as well. If you go to lakes in the watershed of the Baltic Sea, you actually have lakes that were full of cyanobacteria from the year 800 to 1200 or 1300. Due to the changes in agriculture. The plow, the iron plow, came to Scandinavia, and you began to turn over soils, and there were actually lots of intensive nutrient recycling you can do, including the use of manure. And we think that that had a big impact. And then it disappeared again around the year 1200 to 1300, and we think this had a lot to do with the Black Death. Sweden lost half its population during the Black Death, and it also became cooler during the Little Ice Age. I think what's puzzling about this whole thing is hypoxia disappeared again for probably 600 years, and then it came back about 100 years ago, 120 years ago. So is it a natural feature of the Baltic? To some extent, yes. There were probably areas of the Baltic, the deepest area that probably has been hypoxic the whole time. But there has been these intervals, and the driving factors have changed, and humans have played a big part in that as well. I'm a biogeochemist, and so I have to talk something about the nutrients, nitrogen and phosphorus. So one of the interesting things, and this was discovered by Mortimer and Lakes in the 1940s, when you have hypoxia, you change the iron cycle, you reduce iron oxides, and phosphorus that's stored in the sediments comes up into the water column. So you can see that during these periods where there's no oxygen, we have lots of phosphorus in the water column. And then during this stagnation period, for example, when we had very little saltwater inputs and it became oxic, that the phosphorus disappears from the water column and starts to be stored as iron oxides in the surface sediments. So the phosphate concentrations are very strongly controlled by the internal biogeochemical cycles. I think what's really interesting about it is the nitrogen cycle. And I bet you never thought I would say that the nitrogen cycling was interesting, but you know, it happens now and then. And in a healthy Baltic Sea, and in a healthy system where you have oxygen reaching the bottom, probably most of the denitrification occurs down in the sediments. But the Baltic is like OMZ, an oxygen minimum zone. It's permanently hypoxic. It changes some from year to year, but probably most of the denitrification is occurring in the chemocline. And we see this from measurements as well. We know that denitrification, there's no nitrate in the bottom water column. In the bottom, there's no oxygen. And you need those for denitrification to occur. But we can see denitrification at the chemocline, very similar to what you see in oxygen minimum zones. So I think one of the important questions is, what about the future of the Baltic Sea? So what are we going to do when we start to reduce nutrients? Is it going to improve the system or not? And there's several things I want to talk about here. And the first one is that getting rid of hypoxia is probably one of the big challenges that we have. When you have hypoxia, you kill the benthic organisms. You kill the organisms that are mixing carbon down, the ones that are bio-irrigating and putting oxygen down into the sediments as well. And you go from an oxic regime where aerobic metabolism is the dominant pathway to a system that's dominated by anaerobic metabolism. Denitrification is reduced. You get these sediment fluxes of phosphorus. And these things have had a big impact on the Baltic Sea. We have problems with cyanobacteria, as you saw on the first slide, due to the high phosphorus inputs. It's one of the unique systems in the world that has a relatively low salinity, but still has a cyanobacteria blooms. And so I think the problem is going back is going to be difficult. How do you oxygenate the system and get oxygen into the sediments? And so there have been a number of changes that have occurred as well. For example, changes in temperatures. This is work that we have done in Denmark. And when you change the temperature, you change the oxygen saturation in the water column significantly. You increase rates of respiration, and you also increase stratification in the water column. And all these things contribute to the increase in hypoxia in coastal waters. And this is, okay. And you can see these two different time periods in Danish coastal waters in 1998, which is pretty much an average year where you have hypoxia in a variety of systems. You have it some in the coastal systems of the Limfjorden, and you have it down here in the Little Belt. And this year, temperatures were 4 degrees higher, and you can see these areas that had much more hypoxia. And this is probably what we're going to experience in the future with warmer temperatures, is increases in hypoxia because of the lower oxygen saturation, the higher rates of respiration, and also the increased stratification of the water column. There are models that have been done. This is from an ensemble of models in the Baltic Sea. And this is what the data says. The top line is the business as usual if nutrients begin to increase. And what's interesting is at some point you don't see an increase in hypoxia because it's physical processes that will control the oxygen concentrations. It can only go so far up into the permanent halocline as the limit. You have a reference, if you cut off nutrient inputs and don't increase, it'll still be present. And if we implement the full Baltic Sea action plan, it's very likely that hypoxia will decline, but we're not going to get rid of hypoxia. And this is the interesting thing. How much hypoxia can we live with in the future? And what impact is it going to have from the system? I will note that this was from an ensemble of models. The models weren't really made to look at increases or changes in hypoxia through time. And I would suggest that maybe a couple of the models really weren't the best models to use. But it at least tells you that we're going to have to live with hypoxia. And I think that's one of the things that we're struggling with. People are hoping for natural processes to help. We have these intermittent saltwater inflows. And in 2014, and we had a very large input of in December of saltwater. And you can see the saltwater coming in here that's up in the lower part of the Baltic Sea, in the Bornholm Basin and the Arkona Basin. And you can see how in the Gotland Deep we have this big area that's anoxic. And if we look at it a little bit later, it turns out this salt water moves into the system, and this is in July. And you can see increases in salinity here in the Gotland Basin. But one of the things that you see is you take the hypoxia and you move it further up the system. So people used to think about these inflows. They come in, and they thought of it like a mixed batch reactor. New salt water would come in. It would mix up with the bottom water, and there would be oxygen. And it turns out that it pushes, the salt water pushes the other less dense salt water out of the deeper basin and up into the shallower waters. So we have even more hypoxia in the Gulf of Finland, for example, than we had before. And so it'll take time for this water in the shallower areas to be mixed downward. So it's one of the reasons why when we have these saltwater inflows, it's great for a period of months to half a year, but then the oxygen concentrations are reduced from the from respiration, from all the chemical equivalents that are in the sediments, and so we end up with larger areas of hypoxia. And so people have been talking about, how do we get rid of hypoxia? Are there other mechanisms that we can use to get rid of hypoxia? And one of the big things they talk about is geoengineering. So putting some kind of system in, or doing some kind of manipulation to improve the health of the Baltic Sea ecosystem. And there are different things to think about. And one of them is the time scale of improvements is going to take decades. I mean, it took us 50 to 100 years of excess nutrient loading to really change the Baltic Sea. It's going to take an equal amount of time for concentrations to be reduced in the Baltic Sea. Geoengineering promises rapid improvements if we can do something to add oxygen to the system. The cost of nutrient reductions to society are really enormous. To build sewage treatment plants, to deal with all the animal husbandry and the nutrients that go onto the fields. And it really costs a tremendous amount of money. And at least the people promoting geoengineering says it's a cheaper alternative. We can just do geoengineering and fix the system. And it's actually very popular in the media and politically attractive. And could you imagine if you were the political party and you fixed the oxygen in the Baltic Sea, you would probably be elected forever after that. So we got money from this organization called Baltic Sea 2020, and we ran a series of models and did a number of different scenarios. And the first thing we asked is, can we add oxygen to the Baltic? And it turned out there's a gas pipeline going in that will go from Russia to Germany. And they were saying, let's put aerators on this gas pipeline. And so you have to remember that the average is about 49,000 square kilometers. It's bigger than the state of Rhode Island. It is really humongous. It's closer to the size of Maryland, actually. It would require 2 to 6 million tons of oxygen to be added each year to the system. And to put that in perspective, I don't know if you've ever seen these pressurized railroad cars. It would take 20,000 to 60,000 railroad cars of pure liquid oxygen to be placed in the bottom of the Baltic Sea every year. And it's enormous. It's really hard to make this kind of change. So there's other things that have been discussed. So in this modeling, we also decided, well, let's turn the Baltic into a lake. Let's stop the saltwater inflows. Let's take one of the sills and close the sills. That's very easy to do in a model. And one of the things turned out is that it did improve the areas of hypoxia. It took 30 years to do it. And in the meantime, it became worse. But it probably is illegal. There are these things in Europe called the habitat directives. You know, there's people that want cod and want the sea mammals in there as well. And so that would change the whole ecosystem. We can increase saltwater inputs to the Baltic Sea. There were a variety of different crazy geoengineering schemes on how to do this. But we thought the easiest thing was just to dig it deeper and double the size of the sills. And again, it's what we know is that the more salt water you put in, the stronger the salinity stratification becomes and the worse the hypoxia gets. And so that doesn't help at all. And then there's this idea about halocline ventilation, and that has gained popularity. And it's taking water above the permanent halocline, so maybe at 60 meters, that's actually more closer to the cold winter water and closer to the salinity, and pump it downward down to maybe 120 meters. And what that would do is it would disrupt the picnic line, and it would make the water less dense, and it would allow more inflows to come into the Baltic, and inflows bring in oxygen to the system, although it is reduced. But it can't necessarily go on forever, because once the salinity builds up, it builds a barrier for more salt water to come in. But the other important thing is what happens to the community that has evolved to have a halocline, a permanent halocline there. What would happen if the Baltic mixed from the surface to the bottom? What would it do to the phytoplankton and zooplankton and other parts of the ecosystem? And just because you add oxygen, it would help the system, of course. But there are things that it probably won't help. There's a lot of experience from Swiss lakes where they add water to these, or add oxygen to these very deep lakes. And it makes the lakes oxic, but it doesn't change the phosphorus recycling. The sediments have enough organic carbon built up where they still are anoxic. And so they're still releasing phosphorus from the sediments. So you may add oxygen to the system, but not release the nutrients that are growing the algae that are creating more organic carbon. And then Anders Stigebrandt has a paper that's out in Ocean Sciences. It's in the discussion section. You're welcome to make comments on it. He claims from a one-box model where it's only phosphorus, he doesn't believe in nitrogen, that if we oxygenate the entire Baltic Sea for a period of 10 years, we won't have to worry about eutrophication anymore. The system will repair itself. So my role, and I think this is a role that Scott would be proud of, it's to ask questions. There's different ways you can do this. And what I don't want to do is become known as a person that's against things. And so what I'm doing is asking questions. And I'm asking questions about what is it going to do to the ecosystems? What's the impact on cod reproduction when the salinity changes? What's the impact on phytoplankton populations or nutrient recycling processes? How much does it really cost to the consumer? They come up with some numbers. I think it'll be about 2 billion euros to put in 100 windmills around the Baltic Sea. But it doesn't take into account the amount that it costs to install the windmills and to keep them going. And windmills are used to power the pumps that are mixing the water. And you can think about the incredible infrastructure that you have to keep these windmills going continuously out in the open waters. And then what about the management questions? Do we stop reducing nutrients? Is it okay if we just do geoengineering? Would it not matter if we stop reducing nutrients? And I think these are all things we have to talk about and work on. There are a couple other things that they've done, large-scale processes. And one of them, is they've talked a lot about phosphorus sequestration. So in a sewage treatment plant, you can add alum, and it precipitates phosphorus out of the system. And so the question is can we enhance the permanent burial of phosphorus? And so Baltic Sea 2020 has this beautiful website, and they're trying to build a sustainable living coast. And so they took a very small estuarine system in the Stockholm archipelago, and they plowed down 2 million euros worth of alum into the sediments. And it's amazing. You go to this estuary, and you have, it's aquamarine water. There's not a drop of phosphorus in there. there's no algae blooms. But the interesting thing is the bottom waters are still anoxic when it becomes stratified. And it's because of there's an organic carbon pool in the sediments that are still consuming the oxygen. So you have this really weird system where you have an anoxic system and no phosphorus in the water column. But there's lots of questions we can ask. Alum takes an incredible amount of energy to produce. And so you need to create a lot of CO2 to create the energy to do that. It's also ethical. What happens if it's not reversible and you start to add alum and you decide you get large changes in pH, for example, that occur when you add alum? And what's the impact on the ecosystem? And then there's also legal considerations. There's the London Convention, where you don't allow dumping at sea of chemicals. This was one of the big things for iron, where they weren't allowed to dump iron in the ocean anymore. It's also illegal to do this. Probably the most interesting one was to change the trophic interactions. There was this plan in Sweden called a plan fish, where they would fish out the intermediate predators out of the Baltic. And so it's the sprat. And the intermediate predators are the one that are eating the zooplankton. And so they thought if there was more zooplankton, there would be less chlorophyll in the water column. And if you also had the sprat, that the sprat are eating the cod eggs. And so if we got rid of the sprat, then the system would become better. And so they had this 5-year plan to fish sprat out of the Baltic, out of the Swedish waters of the Baltic. On year 4, there was this article in Science that the cod are starting. And it turned out there was a very large young of the year class, and there wasn't enough food for them. And cod still, 5 years later in the Baltic, are undernourished. And so they stopped trying to fish out the sprat. And what's interesting about this, in Sweden, everything is open. You can go online and you can find out what my salary is and what my research accounts look like. But you cannot find the final report for this project. But in the meantime, the Baltic Sea is actually getting better. So this is work that we did that was published in Biological Reviews last year. And we used this HELCOM assessment tool where you put a lot of different parameters together, including a chlorophyll, dissolved oxygen, benthic biomass, the winter nutrient concentrations, secundum, and the sedon. And these are typical European colors that you use in management, and red is very bad, and blue is what you would like. And you can see with the increase in nutrients, and the system really responded to this. And you can see the Baltic Sea appears to be getting better. And so we've had real nutrient reductions in many of the systems. This is a very long residence time system of 30 years. So we think that the improvements are occurring in the Baltic Sea. When I first moved there in 1995, we had mats of ulva that would wash up on Roskilde Fjord on the shores that were 1 and 2 meters high and rot. And those don't exist anymore. There are less chlorophyll in the water column. And there are improvements, but we still have hypoxia that's haunting us. And so how do we get rid of hypoxia is still an important question. So it appears and disappears because of different drivers because of climate, especially with the warmer climate, because changes in morphology that changes the salinity structure of the water column and also nutrients. And geoengineering promises rapid improvements, but there are really significant potential ecological effects. And finally, I think we have to focus on the prescribed nutrient reductions in order to achieve a better Baltic Sea. So thanks for listening.
So we are now I will assist if you want
Okay, thank you.
Keep the people under control.
Thank you.
But otherwise, you can simply move ahead. And Teresa Schwimmer, who works at the Coastal Institute, is a recent grad of the Marine Bio Program, is going to be walking around the microphone. So let's begin with you, sir.
That was very good. Thank you. You suggested that increases in agricultural runoff had a negative impact in coastal regions, but not in freshwater. Can you explain that?
So I'm not an author of the paper that has appeared in Global Biogeochemical Cycles. So they were looking at a lot of different drivers. And so they looked at increases in agricultural inputs, and they also looked at increases in urban areas. And it appeared that the increase in hypoxia in the lakes had more to do with the increase in urban areas than the increase in nutrient inputs. And that probably also has something to do with how we deal with nutrients as humans and with building sewage treatment plants and the fertilizer we put on our gardens. If you look per square kilometer, there's higher nutrient loads from urban areas than there are from farm areas. It's just that they're concentrated.
Your pick, Dan.
My pick. Oh, no.
Jeremy's up there.
Well, you talked about the costs of geoengineering, but can you say anything about the costs of not taking action? And what are the main impacts and the costs to society of the hypoxia and the spreading hypoxia?
So right now, the main impacts actually aren't on the fisheries. It has an impact on the fisheries, but you know, we suffer from overfishing in the Baltic Sea. And it's a very serious problem. We have passed legislation to reduce fishing pressure and for countries to pay attention to the maximal sustainable yield, but they're not following the advice of the scientists. And so there's still lots of overfishing in the Baltic Sea today. So that economic cost isn't going to be there. Most of the economic cost is from recreation. So everyone wants to be able to swim in the Baltic Sea during the summer. And when you have hypoxia, you have phosphorus coming up into the upper water column, which means that you have cyanobacteria that will fix nitrogen because it's a strongly nitrogen-limited system during the summer. And so there's lots of cyanobacteria. And then it's slimy to swim amongst all the bacteria, and sometimes even dangerous.
Let's head back there.
How much have you decreased the loadings that you've prescribed, and how much more is the target?
One of the earlier slides, we've actually decreased it a lot. I mean, if you look back on it, it was just amazing. And you see this in a lot of undeveloped regions where you would have a phosphorus in a harbor and big piles of gypsum, and then when the winds blow, and that was, at least for the Øresund region between Sweden and Denmark, it was the largest load of phosphorus coming in from just winds from blowing away fertilizer that was stored out in the open. And so a lot of those big and easy things have been changed. In countries like Denmark, every city over 10,000 people have its own sewage treatment plant. If it's over 50,000 people that serves a community, it has both nitrogen removal and phosphorus removal. And so Denmark has done a great job in terms of reducing nutrient inputs. Sweden instituted phosphorus removal already in the mid-1970s. But there are other sneaky sources. It turns out that something like 25% of Sweden is still using septic tanks. And so there's still a lot of leakage from septic tanks going into the Baltic Sea, and especially at summer houses. So, you know, there are all these sneaky little sources that we still need to turn off. But countries like Denmark also have fertilizer plans. So in order to add nitrogen to your system to grow crops, you have to do a mass balance, so a budget, essentially. So you take soil samples, you measure the amount of nitrogen that's in the soil, you determine what kind of crops you're going to put on, what their nitrogen demand is, and then you get a certificate to buy fertilizer. And those kinds of things have really helped reduce nutrient inputs. But the biggest problem is animal husbandry. I mean, in Denmark, it had up to 30 million pigs a year, and now it's back down to 25 because Russia has stopped buying meat from Europe. But this is a very small country with very intensive agricultural production, and that goes directly onto the fields. And I think we have to start using it for biogas and other ways, and use it as a resource and not just as a waste product.
Let's head down here, and is that Veronica? Was that you? Okay, let's go right there, and then we'll head back over on this side for the next group. Okay.
Oh, thanks for a fascinating talk. That was very good. I have a question. You showed your you had a great slide showing hypoxia coming and going over a very long, long time period. But how did it start in the beginning? Or why did it start in the beginning?
So what we believe happened when salt water started to come into the Baltic, you had a lot of phosphorus that was stored in the sediments, or you had phosphorus stored in the sediments as oxy-iron hydroxides. And then when you had salt water come in, you had sulfite reduction. And sulfite reduction also reduces iron as well. And you had the iron releasing the phosphorus up into the water column. And then you also stabilize the system through stratification. So you weren't getting, anyone who works on hypoxia knows there's two parts of it. It's the increase in organic matter enrichment, and it's the change in hydrography. And so you increase the stratification, and then you had more phosphorus coming up that allowed more cyanobacteria in the water column. So we can see this if we look at pigment abundance and use cyanobacteria biomarkers in the sediments. We can see this very rapid increase in cyanobacteria as it changed from a lake to a brackish water system.
Right there.
I think this is very interesting. So I think in this country we have the image of Europe as being highly regulated, with lots of countries arguing with each other and all that sort of stuff. So I'm wondering how, in that environment, something as insane as trying to knock out one level of the food chain was allowed.
I wish I could answer that one. It was such a surprise. You know, it was partly driven by science. There was a paper that appeared in PNAS about intermediate trophic levels and predation on zooplankton and the correlation with chlorophyll. But if you look at the data in the paper, it was only during the July and August period that they had correlations between this, but they extrapolate over to the entire year. So, you know, it must be that, you know, getting rid of the sprat was a good idea. And that was... it was shocking, but yeah.
Yeah, we'll pick it right now. We'll come back down here.
Darn good job, Dano. Question for you. Fairly easy to regulate or at least monitor point sources, which you said both Denmark and Sweden are pretty good at. As you also mentioned, animal husbandry is a gaping hole, as it is in America. Clean Water Act allows farmers to spread their feces of animals that they feed but don't grow that food that they feed them almost anywhere. What's the situation like in the Baltic countries with respect to that gaping loophole of spreading animal feces upon your land? And of course, how does that then relate to, which I suspect mostly moving is the nitrogen from that?
So the there are a lot of different countries that are part of the former Soviet Union. And so the Baltic states, it's Estonia, Latvia, and Lithuania, do not have very intense agricultural agriculture, period. And so they're really not the worry. It's Poland that's the worry. It turns out that a lot of farmers from Denmark and the Netherlands don't like the rules, and so they move to Poland where the rules aren't as heavily enforced. There's also these weird things that can happen. There are things called nitrogen-sensitive areas that they could that each country designates. And so all of Denmark is a nitrogen-sensitive area because you're no more than 50 kilometers away from the coast. Poland has a very small area they designate as nitrogen-sensitive area. So they can use nutrients differently, but it's all these farmers that are moving there and increasing the animal husbandry. And that's the biggest fear, is that all the countries reduce it, and then Poland increases it. And then there's serious problems with Russia as well. And Russia actually, through the World Bank, they built sewage treatment plants with phosphorus removal in the city of St. Petersburg. So two of the three plants all remove phosphorus. And then there's another Kaliningrad in Belarusia. They're building a sewage treatment plant. And that's a point source of 3 million people that will be cured by building the sewage treatment plant. But their animal husbandry is virtually unregulated. So there was a Finnish scientist that went there. They made a mistake, and they changed their monitoring stations for river inputs. And instead of being in front, further up in the watershed, they moved further down in the watershed, closer to the coast. And so they catch all the animal husbandry, all these chicken farms, and the amount of nutrients just skyrocketed. So there were estimates that they could have been putting in like 4% of the total phosphorus load to the entire Baltic Sea from this one stream, small river. So it's a serious problem that is not being addressed right now.
You had a question next, and then we'll move up to you, okay? I hold your hand up so Teresa can see where she's heading to be ready.
Thank you. You made me fascinated about the nutrient ratios. So it sounds like they come in one ratio, get used up to some degree to create organic matter, which then sinks, creates hypoxia, then all this extra phosphorus comes up, then creates or stokes nitrogen fixation, which then is the problem. So does it? What ratio could, and then the follow-up would be, is there a geoengineering potential in engineering the ratios so you can prevent the nitrogen fixers?
Actually, it's a really interesting question because they have done this in the archipelago of Stockholm. They built an advanced sewage treatment plant that had both phosphorus removal and nitrogen removal, and they manipulated the ratios. So during the summertime, they allowed more nitrogen to come out to reduce the cyanobacteria abundance. And it worked in the upper part of the estuaries. But actually, most of the nutrients come in from the Baltic into the coastal zone. So it kind of worked, but you know, to geoengineer the whole Baltic. This was actually one of the things that Anders Stigebrandt suggested in 2006. It was to, after, so you have the spring bloom, and the spring bloom sucks out all the nitrogen out of the water column. But there's still phosphorus left, and that which allows cyanobacteria to come. But he suggested that they fly planes over the Baltic and fertilize the Baltic with nitrogen so we wouldn't have cyanobacteria.
Somewhere there's a, am I on this? Is this working? Somewhere there's a paper that said that, that shows that anoxic fjords store carbon about 40 tons per square kilometer. So the Baltic is storing carbon, perhaps a million tons or 2 million tons a year. If you got rid of the anoxia, not only would you stop that storage, but you'd be throwing more carbon back into the atmosphere, and the Marshall Islanders might not be so happy with you.
You're absolutely right. It's interesting, if you look at the Gotland Deep and the deepest, and one of the deeper basins of the Baltic, over the last 100 years, the organic carbon concentrations have gone from 5% to up to 25%. And so there is tremendous amounts of carbon stored there. But it also means that even if we can, if we did the geoengineering and adding oxygen, those systems have so much respiratory equivalence in there that it'll be a while before they become oxic and actually can store phosphorus.
We have a question right here.
Thanks for a nice talk. So if the system is, by all accounts, naturally hypoxic, if you look at the whole scene, to what degree, to what degree does the rest of the ecosystem shift if you actually got rid of the hypoxia? So if that phosphorus flux is potentially supporting productivity that is part of this herring that is so beloved.
It's absolutely clear that you've had, with eutrophication, you've had increases in fisheries abundance. There's more herring and other fish species because you have more chlorophyll there. So if we reduce nutrients, we're going to reduce the productivity of the Baltic and the secondary production. So I think that you have seen this in a variety of other systems as well.
So
you see changes in phytoplankton species composition, and you'll see big changes in the ecosystem. In the coastal areas, depending on how close they are to the nutrient source, a lot of the submerged aquatic vegetation are covered in slime, and covered in epiphytes and other things. And I think when you reduce nutrient concentrations, because a lot of the nutrient concentrations are also coming from the outer waters into the Baltic Sea. So I think you will change the ecosystem quite a bit. All the stuff is all wrapped up together. I mean, you have the overfishing. We've built dams. Nearly every river in around the Baltic Sea is dammed and has numerous dams on them that stops the adronomous fish from migrating. You filled in harbors and you filled in wetlands and made harbors. I mean, there's a variety of multi-stressors that have changed. The Baltic has really high contaminants. They're going down in concentrations, but the amazing thing is you can't the herring that they catch in Sweden can't be sold on the open market, but you can sell it and eat it in Sweden. And so there are these problems as well. Because the contaminant levels are too high, the PCB levels are too high. They'll let their people eat it.
Okay, so we have a question way up there.
Thanks for a really thoughtful talk, Dan. My question's about the heat index graph that you put up, the multimetric estrogen index. It's obviously that tool is very intriguing to managers. I'm wondering offhand if you know what the various loadings are on each of the components of that, and how that might change as nutrient loads go down?
Yeah, you'll have to look at the paper. I don't have the relative importance of the different loadings, but this is one of the problems when you start to do ecosystem indicators and you start to put different indicators together and, you know, how you weight them and how important they are. And so we're working on a project trying to look at the next generation of indicators. But it's something that can be discussed, definitely.
Thanks.
May I jump in and ask a question here?
Yes, ma'am.
One of the things that I thought was interesting was when you were talking about geoengineering, you were talking about the whole issue of political affinity, let's put it that way, for the use of geoengineering, which doesn't necessarily align with political will. Yeah. And I'm curious, one, where the two countries are with regard to political will. And the second thing is, just from what you're reading, hearing, possibly being horrified by in the United States, where do you think it compares in terms of political popularity and will?
There's really no comparison between the United States and the Baltic Sea. You have 14 countries that work together. This was established during the time period when the Berlin Wall still existed. And it was scientists that wanted to have a dialogue about what was happening with the Baltic Sea. And so it was a group of countries that worked together. So afterwards, this group of people were still together. And so the monitoring around the Baltic is coordinated at high levels. We're all using the same techniques to measure nutrients and chlorophyll. And we're all cooperating together. But there are differences about how they're managed. Both Sweden and also Finland have proposed to do geoengineering to HELCOM. And HELCOM said simply no, they're not interested at all, that they need to work on nutrient reductions. And I think that has a lot to do with the work that we've been publishing and the voices that are coming from a variety of different scientists. And I think that has definitely had a positive impact. The other thing is there are countries like Germany that completely think you should not do geoengineering at all, that we have to do things other. And it has to do more with the way that the countries think than anything political or non-political. But it's really difficult to compare because there is a very strong will and a sense of environmental awareness in Scandinavia, especially, that's not apparent here.
That was put very graciously, I think. That's because of old school citizenship. So it's anyone else with a closing question? And if not, you can certainly approach Dan at the reception, and he would be happy to, he has full permission to talk and chew at the same time, and talk to you about anything you have questions about. But thank you so much, Dan. This is a great talk, and we're really